and welcome to the Penguin Prof channel. I've got a chemistry basics video for you today, osmolarity, osmolality, and tonicity. We're going to start with moles and molarity and molality. Don't be scared. We're going to do it Penguin Prof style. That's going to get us to osmolarity and osmolality. This will have an allied health focus so you guys can understand the units that are on those IV bags. And then we'll finish up with tonicity. So let's get into it. We're going to start with moles. Not those. Get those checked. Not those either. Did you know they smell in stereo? We're talking about chemistry, okay? Don't be scared of this. A mole is a standard. It's just shorthand for a huge number, but it's a standard like other standards that you know, like a dozen. Oh, thank you. A pair of socks, a case of beer. Moles are just like that. It's just that it's an enormous number. So it's shorthand for 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd. That's a huge number. We call that Avogadro's number. Boy, he's a little creepy, isn't he? Chemists use this for things like atoms, ions, and molecules, and it's super convenient because it allows us to convert numbers of atoms or molecules and grams. In 2018, the definition of a mole changed to the number of atoms in exactly 12 grams in carbon-12. So you can have a mole of carbon, a mole of glucose, a mole of penguins. Oh, can I have a minute? Oh, that's good. In this video, we're talking about the number of moles dissolved in a solvent. So now that you're more comfortable with moles, let's get into it. So here we have a solvent, for example, water. You can measure the solvent in either weight or volume. That's important. Don't forget about that. Into the solvent, we're going to put solutes, like salt, and we can measure solutes in weight. When we put the solutes in the solvent, now we have a solution. And this is not complicated, you guys. We do this all the time. So the question then is, how sweet do you want your coffee? So you're asking, what's the concentration of those things, in this case, the sugar or the salt, in the solvent? So there's lots of different ways to measure concentration. We're going to look at two. One option is to measure the moles of solute per volume of solution. The other option is to measure the moles of solute per weight of the solvent. Okay, so that's the difference between molarity and molality. Molarity is the number of moles of solute per liter, and we use a capital M to designate that. Molality is the number of moles of solute per kilogram of solvent, and we use a little m for that. Okay, graphically, here it is. Moles per liter is molarity. Moles per kilogram is molality. Oh, you guys, people confuse these all the time. And no wonder there's only one letter difference between them. How do you remember them? This is how I do it. I think about the letter R in liter and the letter R in molarity. So I think molarity and liter. I'm sorry, that's the best I could do, but hopefully that will help you to remember it. So this would be the molarity of your coffee versus the molality of your coffee. Okay, if you have found this helpful so far, can you take a second and click some of those buttons below? Another thing you can do if you want to support the channel is check out Audible and download a free audiobook of your choice. The book I'm going to recommend today is Atomic Habits. This book can change your life. No joke. So now that we have molarity and molality, we can finally talk about osmolarity and osmolality. Okay. You got to remember osmosis for this. Remember that we can have a U-shaped tube with water and a semi-permeable membrane. We can add solutes on one side. These are non-penetrating solutes, right? So the solutes can't cross, only water can cross. And water will move to follow the solutes, even against gravity. Pretty amazing, right? That's osmosis. Now, the osmotic pressure that we see in this tube is determined by the number of particles in solution, right? The more particles you have, the higher the osmotic pressure will be. Size of the particles doesn't matter, and neither does shape or charge. The osmole is the unit that we use. It's the number of moles of solute that contribute to the osmotic pressure of a solution. Okay, now here's where it's going to get pretty cool. Okay, pay attention to this. One mole of glucose. When you put glucose in water, what happens to it? Nothing. But what about one mole of sodium chloride? Now that sodium chloride will dissociate into ions. You get two particles, sodium and chloride. What about something like K2SO4, potassium sulfate? That comes apart and makes three particles. So while the number of moles of each of these compounds is the same, right, we have one mole of each, the osmoles are different. So that's one osmole of glucose, that's two osmoles of sodium and chloride, and that's three osmoles of potassium sulfate. So this is really important for osmotic pressure. It's the number of particles, not moles. It's the number of particles that matter. If you want more details on this, check out the Van 't Hoff factor. That's the number, the one, the two, the three. Check that out if you want to hear more about that. So osmolarity and osmolality are going to be the concentration of those particles that contribute to osmotic pressure, just like molarity and molality were the concentration for moles. So this is all about concentration, but you guys, you already get this, right? We're going to be talking about measuring the concentration either per unit volume or weight. So you fill in the blank. Blank is the measure of solute concentration per unit volume. Is it going to be osmolarity or osmolality? You remember that R in liter? Sure you do. That's osmolarity. So osmolality is the measure of solute concentration per unit mass. Now, osmolarity is more intuitive, especially, again, we're talking about healthcare, so we're usually talking about volume of blood, for example. Osmolality is less intuitive because we don't really talk about how many kilograms of blood somebody has. Osmolarity is more practical for that reason, but osmolality is more accurate because it's independent of pressure and temperature, right? Because volume changes with pressure and temperature, whereas weight does not. Osmolarity is going to be calculated from the CMP, and I want you guys to pay attention to this if you're allied health folks. Most of the osmolarity is due to sodium. Sodium is the VIP at the party for sure. By the way, BUN is just blood urea nitrogen. Osmolality we can measure with an osmometer, and this is what an osmometer looks like. It measures the depression of freezing point. The take-home message here is that you can see now why these two terms are often used interchangeably, but now you know better. They're not the same thing. In clinical applications, the difference between the two is usually less than 0.5%, but because one is calculated and one is measured and you will see them both, you do need to know the difference, and now you do. All right, we're going to talk about tonicity. It's the measurement of the osmotic pressure gradient between two solutions. We're going to talk about water and sodium and chloride. These are non-penetrating solutes, which means that the solutes, the sodium and chloride, the red triangles, they don't cross into or out of the cell. We're just watching the movement of water. Option one, there are more solutes in the solution compared to the cell. We call that a hypertonic solution. Option two, there are more solutes inside the cell compared to the water outside. That we call hypotonic. And then the third option is there's equal numbers of solutes on both sides. We always describe the solution with respect to the cell. Okay, we're going to describe the direction of osmosis and predict the cell's response. Water always moves to follow the solute. So where is the solute? In a hypertonic solution, it's outside the cell. So water is going to flow out. What's going to happen to the cell? It's going to shrink, right? It's going to lose volume. What about a hypotonic solution? Where's water going to go? It's going to follow the solute, always. What's going to happen to the cell? It's going to either swell or burst. What about an isotonic solution? Well, there's going to be no net movement of water. It's going to flow in and out at equal rates, and the cells will remain the same size. And that's it. So you just remember that water always moves to follow the solute. Here's what hyper, hypo, and isotonic solutions look like when you put red blood cells in them. Interestingly enough, there are clinical applications for all three. So there are conditions where you would want to administer a hyper or a hypotonic solution. You do want to be careful with those, especially a hypertonic solution. Usually those need to be put in a central line because hypertonic solutions can damage veins. But anyway, I just wanted you to see that. And here are some examples for those of you who are in the healthcare field of the solutions that are typically used in each of these categories. You guys, that was a lot. Thank you so much for visiting the Penguin Prof channel. I hope that was helpful. If it was, please click those buttons below, and I will see you in the next video. Good luck.